did it. 1 Samuel chapter 3. Tonight. Our friend Samuel, young Samuel, I don't know how old is he here, maybe 10 or 12 years old. He is going to have encounter with God. Now he's a young man, he's not an old guy. He's going to be the incredible prophet, but he's young. Young people, listen, you don't have to wait till you're old to serve the Lord. You can serve the Lord at a young age. Samuel started off at a young age. You know, his mom brought him in at 3 years old or something. He's been living in a godly situation. And being raised in the ways of the Lord since a young boy. So in this chapter, he's going to have that encounter. As a matter of fact, it says there, that Samuel really doesn't know the Lord yet. He's serving the Lord. He's walking with the Lord. But he really doesn't know him yet. Look at this verse 7 in Samuel chapter 3. It says, "Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor had the word of the Lord yet been revealed to him, but he's seeking him out with his whole heart." Bible is clear that if you seek God out, you'll find him. That's the answer for anyone who says to you, well, how can there be a God? How can the people in India or in the depths of Africa or in China, how are they going to know God is? There's no churches there. If they seek the God of the Bible out, if they see creation and say, you know what? I know in my heart that everyone knows because of creation that God exists. That's what my Bible says. And you seek that Creator out, who is God, our God, he will reveal himself to you. So, Samuel did not yet know God, about probably 12 or 13 years old, but he's worshiping the Lord, he's walking in his ways, he's serving him, and you know, and sometimes, maybe you feel that way. Maybe you feel, you know, I really don't know God, I don't know God like my brother over here or my sister over here, I don't know the word. They know the word and they quote the word and, you know, I don't know it. Sometimes you feel, you know, like kind of left out because I don't have the gift of tongues. I pray for people to heal. I never see them get healed. Never seems to be anything spiritual happening in my life. You know what? If that's you tonight, just hang in there. Just hang, keep seeking God because he's going to speak to you. He will speak to you because he does the Samuel. Samuel hasn't had any of those experiences yet. You're in good company. You're with Samuel. So don't feel left out. Don't give up. You may go years, like Samuel, before God really reveals himself to you. I look at my life, different stages of my life. When I gave my life to the Lord at a very young age, I didn't walk for many years. And then I finally got to the point of, like, I'm sick of my lifestyle. I want to know who you are. You know, and then my life started changing. God revealed himself more to me. And then it got to the point where, you know what, I really want to know who you are. And I started reading the Word and seeking him out. And God then spoke to me. And he did things, and incredible things in Miss Anna's life and in my life when we made that choice. But it took a while. You know, there was some time in there. It just didn't happen. Those things didn't happen overnight. So sometimes years go by before you hear the voice of the Lord. Now it says in 1 Samuel chapter 3, it says, "Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord before Eli. And the word from the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were infrequent." You know, it was during the time, kind of a dry time in Israel's history, where nobody was really hearing from God. There weren't dreams, there weren't visions, and God wasn't speaking to them. I wonder if it's because of the condition of the people. Maybe they weren't seeking God out. We know that Eli, his family was compromising. His sons were doing evil things. I mean, prostitutes in the temple, starting temple prostitution. I mean, all kinds of evil things were happening. So God wasn't speaking. Now, I think that sometimes in our lives, you know, we seem dry. Not necessarily, but sometimes in our life, we need to look and see what's going on in my heart. What's going on in my life? Are there things that I need to deal with and get rid of? You know, that it's God, I'm just not hearing God. Sometimes we find out, oh, there's some areas in my life you need to be cleaned up, and so God's getting my attention here, okay? But it may not be that way. Maybe sometimes God lets us have that dry time so we walk in faith. You know, it's easy to walk with God when, you know, there's a money tree growing in your backyard. You know, $100 bills are popping up, you grab them, yeah, I love God, man. You know, know, you see some of these TV preachers are like that, you know, they got all this stuff, you know, so it's kind of easy. But, you know, when that's not happening, it just seems like regular, every day, go to work, take care of the kids, life. Go to school, life. Well, here I am in church again on Sunday, life. It just seems dry. It's because sometimes God wants us to walk a level of faith. Not what we see, not circumstances, but faith. Lord, I'm going to believe you even though I don't sense anything. There's not a bunch of feelings. This doesn't seem like, you know, wee, time in life. I'm still going to walk with you. It's a walk of faith. You know, my friend, I shared with some of you before, Mr. Mick, you know, and Jordan was his son who was here. You know, Mick had incredibly huge trial in his life when his wife committed adultery on him, got pregnant by another man while he was off climbing a mountain. He comes back, she says, I love another man. Now, you know, I don't know about you guys here, but for us, you know, that would devastate me. That's not a normal kind of life for me. You know, like, if Miss Anna committed adultery, I'd be wasted. That's just not going to happen. We don't accept that. So he was devastated. So he just turned to the Lord. He didn't turn to drugs. He didn't turn to alcohol. He didn't turn to women. He didn't go out to a bunch more women. He turned to God and His Word and started reading God's Word and seeking God with his whole life. And man, God was speaking to him. I mean, this guy, it was just incredible watching him grow in the Lord. Incredibly. For the first year, Miss Anna and I kind of adopted him, took care of him, raised him in the Lord. This guy was just like growing leaps and bounds. And then one day, he's saying, where's God? God's not speaking to me. I'm not hearing the voice of the Lord. He's not directing me. What's going on? You know, and then the next day, he's still not here. You know, and after about a week or something, you know, I get a little time period that's going on in his life, and so him and I are sitting down talking about it. Maybe the honeymoon's over. Now God's going to let you walk in faith now. Instead of speaking to you, okay, turn right, turn left, go to the bathroom now, eat now, you know, like a baby. That's kind of how his life was. God just lifted his hand up and said, now you walk on your own 2 feet. It becomes, when your child grows, right, that baby gets to a certain point, it's going to have to walk on its own, huh? And God does that with us. Because when you're first born again, you're a baby, and God, you know, he treats you like a baby. He feeds you milk. You know, you don't go sticking steak down the baby's throat, you know, when the baby comes out. Gag and die. So God doesn't do that either. But then when you get on your own feet, he says, now you take some steps. And he lets you take steps and fall. You know, then you get up, you take more steps. And that's our walk in faith. That's faith. Oh God, I'm going to believe you. I'm going to believe your word. Even though I don't sense you and I don't feel you, I'm going to just keep walking. I'm going to take that next step. I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep my eyes on the finish line, which is Jesus in eternity when I die. I'm with him. The finish line. So that happens in our lives. Now, so nobody been hearing from the Lord for quite a long time. Dry times, right? So in verse 2 it says, it happened at that time as Eli was lying down in his place. Now his eyesight had begun to grow dim and he could not see well. And the lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was, that the Lord called Samuel and said, and then Samuel said, here I am. So the Lord spoke to Samuel. It's kind of end of the day, you know, Eli's crashing out, things are happening, Samuel's there in the temple, and all of a sudden he hears, Samuel, I said, Samuel, I don't think he said that way, he just probably said, Samuel. Spoke to him. He heard the voice of the Lord, Samuel. And then in verse 5 it says, then he ran to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call you, lie down again. So he went and laid down again. You know, it's interesting in this that he is speaking to Samuel and not Eli, not the prophet Eli. He's speaking to Samuel here, and Samuel runs into, because he doesn't know, he's never heard the voice of the Lord. If you're sitting at home, and you're in your bedroom, and a voice says, Joyce, Miss Delverine, God wouldn't be in prison. She would run in the other room and go, who called me? Who's talking to me, right? Wouldn't you do that? Want to know how I know? Because one time in my life it happened. One time in my life, all my years as Christian, one time I heard the voice of the Lord. And all he said was, Jim. And there was nobody around, anywhere. And I went in every room, and I looked everywhere. I looked in every nook and cranny, and there was nobody there. And I realized God called my name, and I started laughing. It freaked me out. Because I was kind of, my mind wasn't in the right place, and God was one. Woke me up. Okay, I get it. Only once. I don't ever want to hear a kid done it. Unless it's, come up here, you know? Come up. I don't want to hear it, because that kind of circumstance. You know, this young man, Samuel, is ministering to the Lord when he hears his voice. It reminds me kind of Paul and Barnabas. When they ministered to the Lord spoke to him. It says in Acts 13:2, it says, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Spirit said to them, now separate to me Barnabas and Saul for the work which I have called them. You know, they're in that place of serving the Lord, walking with the Lord, and the Lord speaks to them. And he does that in our lives, too. He speaks to us. Not audibly, okay? I'm not telling you to go home and wait for him to speak to you audibly, but he speaks to us through his word and a still small voice in us, okay? Well, those times, especially, that you just love spending with the Lord. Times of worship when you're alone, you're praying. You know, Miss Anna does that a lot. You know, she stays up real late at night. She just sings to the Lord all the time. Because I always wonder, how come God gives her all these great worship songs, you know, that she writes these great songs? I don't get any. I don't stay up to 3 or 4 in the morning singing songs to him. That's always not giving to him. But he's giving it to her because she's doing that. And those quiet times, he speaks to her. And notice where he speaks to Samuel. In the temple. He's in the temple. Now, you and I, where is the temple of God now? In us. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. He lives inside of us. So he wants to speak to us. And also, we can look at that as this is another place he'll speak to you in what we call church. He'll speak to you through his word, hopefully by the pastor up here sharing the word, that maybe he speaks to you, you get something out of it. I'm not just a spirit. You know? But God can speak to you through his word and a Bible study. You know, when the pastor teaching, God will speak to you. The other brothers and sisters in the church, as you share things with them and they share with you, God will speak to you through them. This doesn't have to be his audible voice, but he'll speak to you in many ways. Through time of worship. You know, you may be going through something, and all of a sudden you start singing a worship song, and that song just ministers to your heart. Yes, Lord. Oh, God. Yes. You know, I mean, one of the songs that really, I just love and ministers to me so much is that as we sang, as long as I live, as long as I live, that song. Oh, when I sing, I'm like, oh, yeah, Lord. Oh, God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. You know what? When I sing that song, I'm not singing words. I'm singing my heart. That to me is a heartfelt song. You know, usually when Miss Ann and I put together a song list, we're not looking for, hey, that's a pretty cool song. Let's do that song because it's cool. We're looking at, what does that song say? That song is going to minister to my Lord. Is that going to minister to people? Is that going to minister to us? And so when we're singing, hopefully, I'm not saying every time I sing a song, I'm in that special place of like, you know, my mind strays also just like yours. But I have learned through the years how to control it, you know, to try to keep it back in focus. So when I'm singing to him and I'm not thinking about going to eat later because I need dinner. I'm hungry, man. I need to eat. Lord, 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 but I'm still hungry. Oh, Lord, I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I'm really hungry. You know? Kind of learn to control those things. And just think about that. So when you're singing, you know, and the words are up there, think about those words. Think about what they're saying. And sing them to him. You'll notice that we do a lot of songs here where we like to sing to the Lord. Not just about the Lord. But to him. Now, you can't sing to somebody unless they're there. I mean, I can come right over here and sing this song to Miss Anna. Miss Anna, I love you. Oh. better. But you know, a lot of times we sing these songs, I love you, but you're not singing to it. Just mouthing words. It comes out with whoo. So you have to take your mind and focus and think about it. Oh, Lord, I'm saying, I love you. I'm giving you my life right now, Lord. You know? I mean, anyhow, enough of that. Speaks in our hearts through a word of correction. Somebody rebukes us or exhorts us, you know. In our hearts, he will speak to us. You know, it'll be here to be, you know, that's right. I need to clean that up in my life. Oh, Lord, I shouldn't be doing that. He speaks to us that way. That's why it is so important that the Bible says, do not forsake the gathering together of the brethren. In other words, come together as brothers and sisters. Because we hear from the Lord through one another. It works that way. If you're the lone Christian out there, hey, you know, if you're out there, well, you know, I don't really meet with God out there when I'm out in the sea fishing. Well, when that fish comes out, what does it say to you? Don't eat me. Or God says, you know, I've never had a fish talk to me. But you know, you got a brother or sister who can talk to you, can communicate. Minister to one another. That's why it's good, even when we finish our studies or after church, we don't have to run out the door real quick. You can hang out and talk to somebody. You might be going through something in your life and you need prayer. And you don't have to come to the pastor. Did you know that anybody's prayer in this room is just as effective as mine? Mr. Delano can pray for you. And it's just as effective as my prayer. Because we're brothers and sisters in Christ. We have the same God, the same Holy Spirit lives in us. So you can hang out and say, you know, I really need prayer. That's why it's important you hang out with other believers, okay? So, now, back to our story here. Let's go back to verse 5. Then he ran into Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call you, lie down again. So he went and laid down. The Lord called yet again, Samuel. So Samuel arose and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. But he answered, I did not call you, my son, lay down again. And then verse 7 says, now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor had the word of the Lord yet been revealed to him. So the Lord called Samuel again for the third time, and he arose and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. Then Eli discerned that the Lord was calling the boy, and Eli said to Samuel, go lie down, and it shall be, if he calls you, that you shall say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. God keeps speaking to him, and he keeps going in, Eli, you called me. No, I didn't. And finally, Eli gets it. Ah, he's hearing the voice of the Lord. So he gives him instruction. Next time you hear the voice, say, Lord, here I am. I'm listening. One thing great about Samuel, as you notice, he gets up quickly. You know, he doesn't wait around. When somebody calls his name, he goes. The Lord calls his name, he gets up, and he answers the call, even though he doesn't realize it's the Lord yet. He gets up. Sometimes, you know, the Lord does that for us. He calls us out. Sometimes you might wake up in the middle of the night and you wonder, why am I awake? And God may want to speak to you then. He may have woke you up. Maybe he wants you to pray. Why would you wake up? I mean, unless the baby's crying or something like that. But sometimes you wake up in the middle of the night and God wants to speak to you. And we can go, I'm not getting up right now, man. I'm tired. I'm going to roll back home and go to sleep. I don't want to hear you, Lord. We can do that for you. You know, if you wake in the middle of the night, maybe you say, Lord, am I awake for a reason? Do you want to speak to me? Try that sometime. Now, I'm not very good at that. When I woke up in the middle of the night, I'm grumpy. Don't talk to Miss Ann about it. She doesn't want to say bad things about me. And sometimes she wakes me up in the middle of the night, and I bite her head off. Poor thing. All she wants to know is something good. But I do that. So, he gets up. He goes and lays down again. And now, in verse 11, it says, the Lord said to Samuel, oops, verse 10, I'm sorry. Then the Lord came and stood and called as at the other times, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. Did you notice? He didn't say, speak, Lord. Because he's like, I don't want to be quite sure yet. You know, speak because your servant is listening. place. Like, what is going on? God's going to speak to me? I mean, no, how can that be? I mean, that's what my mind is racing. What's going on here? Then it says, the Lord said to Samuel in verse 11, behold, I am about to do a thing in Israel at which both ears of everyone who hears it will tingle. In that day, I will carry out against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. Now, you might be here tonight and you haven't been in another study, so you don't know what that's talking about. So I suggest to you that you go back and read Samuel chapter 1 and 2. It'll fulfill you, not right now. Because it'll fulfill you in on he has not been dealing with his household properly. His sons were in the temple doing evil, wicked things, and Eli was going, stop it. And not really dealing with it. Something like, you know, parents need to be careful of. You just don't yell at your children. But when you say something, you do it, you follow through with your actions. You know, she'll slap on the hand because they don't have, you know, because to them that's no discipline, and they go do it again anyhow. You know, sometimes you need to be a man or woman of your word. You discipline your children. You make sure you raise them in the ways of the Lord. I mean, you don't beat them to a pulp, and you don't discipline them out of anger. You discipline them out of love so that they walk with the Lord. You didn't do that. And because of that, God says, they're going to die in one day. Okay? And there's the whole story is back in the first few chapters. I don't want that study again. Get it already. But that's kind of filling you up. And so God told him what he was going to do, and that his whole family was going to suffer because of this, because he didn't deal properly with his children. And now he's telling Samuel, I'm going to do it now. And he's telling Samuel that what's going to happen. So he says, in the day, verse 12, I will carry out against Eli all that I've spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I'm about to judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knew, because his sons brought a curse on themselves, and he did not rebuke them. Therefore I have sworn to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be atoned for by sacrifice or offering forever. There's nothing that Eli can do about it. His opportunities were wasted. He did not keep his house in order. Now that is something that you and I need to look at. Now, remember, we're in the Old Testament, and you know, there's a lot of law stuff in the Old Testament, and we live under grace now, but the principles are still there. And what God is saying is, man, if you don't raise your kids in the Lord and you don't take care of business, your family's going to suffer, and your kids are going to suffer for it, and they may even die. That's a pretty intense warning, isn't it? That would make me go as a parent, you know what, I'm going to raise my kids in the Lord, and I'm going to follow through with what I say. I'm going to make sure that they do what's right, and I'm going to deal with it. Sometimes that means, you know what, you can't go there, and you can't hang out with those people anymore because they are bad for you. That's how Miss Ann and I had no children of our own. We raised plenty of children. That's what we did. When they came to our house, we'd say, you're not hanging out with those people because those people bring you down. But, no buts about it, man. You're going to, this is our house, and these are our rules. And we're not doing that to be mean to you. We're doing that because we love you. Or, you know, you could say, well, I want to be a good parent. I'm going to let my kids hang out with all them drug addicts and guys that rape girls. That where you want your daughter to hang out is with the guys that are raping the girls? You don't need to do that. No, you don't want to do that. Watch your kids, man. Know where they're at. Raise them in the ways of the Lord. Don't let them do those things. But you got to start young. Once they're teenagers, it's pretty hard to control them. Then it's a little bit late, man. Then they start zooming. You know, hey, I'm bigger than you now. Some of the boys can beat up their dads when they get that age, you know. So you start young. Start in the ways of the Lord. Well, Eli didn't do that. He's going to suffer for it. Now, you wonder, well, again, why didn't he speak just to Eli about this thing? You know what? Eli's hearing had become dull. He could no longer hear what the Lord had to say to him. Such as sometimes we get to that place. The Lord's dealing with some area in your life of sin, and you keep ignoring him, and your hearing becomes dull, and you don't hear it anymore. And you come to church, and the pastor might even talk about that particular sin, but you don't even hear it. Like, it doesn't even apply to you because you become insensitive and dull and hearing, and your heart has become hardened that you don't even hear it anymore. You just got to do it. That's where Eli is, okay? That's where we get. When we don't listen to the voice of the Lord, when He has good things for us, there's nothing bad about the things. When God says, don't do this, He doesn't say it out of keeping you from having fun. He's keeping you from the trouble. Just for instance, God says to you, you know what? If you don't have sex before marriage, and you wait for one partner, you won't get AIDS. You know, that's a principle of God. And a good, unless through a blood transfusion or something, you probably won't. But you don't listen to the Lord, your chances are you're gambling. So the Lord doesn't tell you not to do that, not to have sex before marriage or outside of your marriage, because He wants to keep you from fun. He wants to keep you from dying. Now, to me, that's love. That's not, oh, what a mean God. But we become dull. But I like it, man. But you know what? It doesn't mean that you're going to go to hell for it. You could be saved if you're doing that, but you could still die from it. Because the consequences of our sin, we are going to suffer for the consequences of our sin. So don't let your hearing, your heart, get dull. Be able to hear what the Lord has said. And when He says it, do it. Otherwise, become more insensitive and more insensitive to those things. So if there are areas God wants to deal with us and correct us, well, we have to have ears to hear. Now, verse 15. So Samuel lay down until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. But Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. Then Eli called Samuel and said, Samuel, my son, and he said, here I am. This time it was Eli talking to him. He said, what is the word that he spoke to you, please? Please, do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all the words that he spoke to you. So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. He said, it is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him. Eli knew that the Lord had spoke to Samuel. And you know, I love Samuel's attitude. You know, Samuel wasn't one of these guys that the Lord spoke to him and they ran around telling everybody, guess what God's going to do to him? Woo-hoo, he's going to get it. I mean, that's what a lot of people do. Oh, yeah? Wow. You know, like, listen to that stuff, right? Now, he didn't even want to talk about it. You know, it probably, in him, it probably grieved his heart, probably broke his heart. He knew that was going to happen to Eli and his family. He was a sensitive young man. He was definitely a godly young man. He had established himself in the Lord. But Eli made him tell him, let God do to you even more if you will tell me every word. I mean, you know what the 12, 13-year-old kid is going to do. He's going to tell him, told him every word. And when he did, Eli knew it already because God told him he was going to do that. He knew the word had spoken to him. What a sad commentary for Eli. Verse 19 and 20 says, thus Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fail. That's a great statement. Hey, Samuel grew in the Lord, and none of the words, none of the prophecies, nothing that he said ever failed. It was all from God. Wow. That's a good thing. And then verse 20, all Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was confirmed as a prophet of the Lord. And the Lord appeared again at Shiloh, because the Lord revealed himself to Samuel at Shiloh by the word of the Lord. As Samuel grew, he could prove himself to the Lord. And God will speak to Samuel through Samuel to the people. That's what a prophet does. A prophet is one who God gives him the words, and he speaks to the people. And then he speaks to God for the people. And Israel chose that. Years earlier, remember when they went at the mountain and God spoke to them audibly, and they all went, oh, no, we want to hear your voice. Let Moses speak to us. Somebody else speak to us, but not you. And they turned their back on God. They didn't want to hear the voice of the Lord. So from that point on, the prophets spoke to the people. God gave them their wishes. So, He established himself in the Lord. What about us? We can be like Samuel, and we can follow after the Lord. It's just an example of a young man who decided to follow the Lord. It wasn't some superhero or something. It was just a regular boy. He could have went one way or the other. His mom dedicated him to the Lord, and he stayed on that path with the Lord. You know, it says in Deuteronomy 28, verse 9, it says, "The Lord will establish you as a holy people to himself, just as he has sworn to you, if you keep the commandments of the Lord your God and walk in his ways." And he gave that to his people, but he gives that to us too. He gives that to you and I. Then he establishes us as a holy people. Holy means set apart. He takes you and I and he sets us apart for himself. He desires that we follow his commandments and his word. That's his desire, that we can do that. Proverbs 16:1 says, "The preparations of the heart belong to man, but the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. All the ways of a man are pure in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the spirits." Isn't that the truth? We all think that we're doing right, but God really knows. You know, he weighs out our heart. He weighs it out to see if we're really right before him. I mean, our ways seem right to us. You know, the thief thinks he's doing fine. I'm doing okay. I didn't get busted, man, so I must be okay. You know, and because there's sometimes not consequences in our life, we think that we're doing okay. And so our heart deceives us into making us feel like we're okay. You can tell a lie and rationalize that was okay to do because you benefited from you somehow or your family. You know, it just, that's the way we are. But God knows, he weighs it out. If we go to him, he'll show us. And verse 3 of Proverbs 16 says, "Commit your works to the Lord and your thoughts will be established." That's good. How do you take control of those wild thoughts that come up? You know, crazy thoughts. You can think anything weird. I mean, I've had thoughts in my life like, where did that come from? But it says there, if we commit our works, our life to the Lord, hey, you know what? Our thoughts will be established. And that will help in that area with our thoughts. Psalm 37:4 says, "Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as light and your justice as noonday." So you delight yourself in the Lord, in the ways of the Lord. Man, you do that, he brings things in your life, he brings good things, and you'll be blessed. I like that. And then, ending with this, Proverbs chapter 3, verses 1, a few verses I'm going to read, says this, "My son, do not forget my law, but let your heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace they will add to you." Number one thing, hey, don't forget my law. Don't forget my word. And keep my commands. Let your heart keep my commands, and your length of days will be long. That's a promise from the Lord. And peace will be added to you. Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Hey, have compassion for people. Have mercy for people. And be truthful. Let that be your heart. Wrap that around your heart. Bind it around your neck. And verse 4, "And so find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and man." You do that. When you're truthful, when you are merciful, you will find favor with man. You'll find favor with God. And then in verse 5 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths." That's a special scripture for all of us. Man. Because we trust in the way we think, and that gets us into jams sometimes. But you know what? We lean on the Lord. We trust in the Lord. Even when it seems weird, it doesn't seem right. Trusting in him, he will guide our paths. Verse 7, "Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones." Listen, I'm going to read that again. "Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and split man from evil." Don't go there. Don't Don't hang out with evil. And when you do that, you will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. Hey, I like that. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with your first fruits of all your increase, so your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord. That's the discipline of the Lord. Don't despise the discipline of the Lord, nor detest his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as a father the son in whom he delights. Just as you, as a mother or a father, you correct your children, God corrects us because he loves us. And that's why you correct your children, because you love them. Principles for walking with the Lord. And Samuel follows those principles. And we're going to see his life in this, the book of Samuel. We see it. We see his dealings with many people in it. And he is a blessing. And if we watch his life, we just apply some of those things in our life. You know, we've covered a lot of things tonight. You know what? Just take something that God gave you tonight out of the study. Put it into your life. Sometimes it's hard when you hear all these things like, well, I'm going to change everything in my life at once. Well, you know what? I couldn't do that. It didn't happen to me that way. You know, all my sin didn't go fleeing in one day. It was like one at a time, man. All right, God, we made it through that one. Okay. Then 2 years on the next one. Oh, we made it through that one, you know. Just one thing. I mean, it'd be great. We could take it all and just do it. Be super men and women Christians. But unfortunately, it doesn't always work that way. So you apply something in your life. You heard that. Lord, that's what I need to work on. Work on it. God, what's next? Ask him. He'll tell you. And he'll give you the strength. And he'll give you the victory, you know? So God bless you. God bless us. God bless Calvary Chapel, St. Mike. God bless St. Mike. God bless this peninsula. God bless Belize. Let's pray. Father, so much in your word, we just look at a saint's life, a prophet in the Old Testament, and how much that can mean to us and show us about our lives, Lord. And so I pray, as I even spoke a moment ago, Lord, that you would take something tonight that we heard from your word, not from me, Lord, but from your word, and apply it into our lives, that I could be a little bit more like you. And then, Father, I pray that you would do that in my heart and in our hearts. And then, Lord, give us something else after that. And let us continually, Lord, be conformed to your image. And we know, Lord, that as that happens, Lord, you just bless us. You take care of us. Your word promises, many promises, and they're for us, Lord. And we believe them and we receive them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you guys once again. Have a great week in the Lord.